Sometimes if we're doing a definite integral, there may be an easier way to compute the definite integral, easier than the fundamental theorem of calculus, if we're familiar with some of the properties of definite integrals. So here in this video, I'm just going to run through a few of the main properties specifically of definite integrals. There are other properties for definite integrals, but I'm only going to look at the ones that are pertinent just to definite integrals. A lot of the properties carry over from indefinite integrals, like you're allowed to pull out a constant outside the integral, or the sum and difference rule, and some of those types of properties. But here I'm just looking at the ones specifically related to just definite integrals and finding the area under the curve. So here we go. All right, the first property says if you're going to take a definite integral from A to A. Normally we go from A to B, like in this last picture here. We're trying to find the area under this curve from A to B. But if your starting point and ending point's the same, just a little common sense will tell you what this answer is. If you're starting at A and then you haven't accumulated any area past A, in fact, you're still stopping at A, then how much area have we accumulated? Well, the answer is obviously zero. And students will overlook this sometimes. You might have some terribly nasty function to integrate on the interval from 4 to 4. And students will try to take that antiderivative and plug in a 4 and plug in a 4 and subtract, but they miss the obvious that the answer would be 0, because whatever the mystery antiderivative is, when you plug in that number such as 4, it's going to be the same end result, you know, for both quantities. And so when you subtract, you'll always get 0. So just make sure we remember that one. Here's our second one. All right. Oftentimes, we integrate from A to B, and we assume naturally that A is less than B. And so more often than not, the integration goes in this direction as far as the order of the limits. A is typically smaller than B. But what would happen, just out of curiosity, if we decided to integrate from B back to A? Would the answer be the same, or, you know, I don't know. Well, let's see. If you integrated from B back to A, from the higher number back to the lower number, it turns out that this is very close to the integral from A to B of f of x dx, but not quite. It turns out to be the negative of whatever that quantity is. Now, you might look at that and say, well, Devin, how is that the case? Because area is area, right? You know, if you integrate from 2 to 7 and 7 to 2, I mean, shouldn't the answers be the same? Well, if you just run through the math real quickly, you'll see how this plays out. All right, up here, if we were just to kind of work out just the basic details, we would take the antiderivative of little f, right? Put our bracket from B to A, right? And then fundamental theorem of calculus says if we plug in A and then plug in B and subtract, we should get the area under this curve in this defined order here. So we'd have capital F of A minus capital F of B. But if we had done this for the integral standard from A to B, these would have been reversed. So what's the difference between capital F of A minus F of B versus capital F of B minus capital F of A? Well, as you well know, if you switch the order of two things that are being subtracted, the only difference is the sign. You know, for instance, if you take 10 minus 7, you get 3, but 7 minus 10, you get negative 3. So this being negative the quantity capital F of B minus capital F of A, which comes from the fundamental theorem of calculus, we see that it's the negative of just kind of your standard integral from A to B. All right, so that could save you a little time. All right, and then our last one here, specific to definite integrals, is when you have a function that's not continuous. Now, let me actually make a comment. I probably should have mentioned this earlier. For these first few up here, the assumption was that the function was continuous from A to B, which means you can always find the area under that curve. If it's continuous on the closed interval A to B, this is always possible. All right, so like in this example and that example, but turns out you can still find the area under a curve, even if it's not continuous, but the only stipulation is this. There has to only be a finite number, so just some handful of numbers, some countable amount of jump discontinuities. So you can't have just any old type of discontinuity. You remember, you can't have like an asymptote that blows up to infinity. You would accumulate infinitely much area underneath that sort of curve. But if it's simply a jump discontinuity, or even a point discontinuity for that matter, we can still do it. And so here's the idea. If you want the area under this curve, you notice there's an abrupt change. There's an abrupt change right here. We'll call it C. Right, and so you're probably seeing where I'm headed with this already, I bet. What we're going to do is we're going to break this up into two definite integrals and then compute each of them respectively because they are continuous on their respective intervals and then kind of proceed from there. So here we go. The first little region one in blue here, this would be the integral from A to C of f of x dx, obviously. So that would give you the area just in region one right here. And then we'll add to that the integral from C to B of f of x dx. And it turns out the sum of these two independent areas turns out to be the total integral from A all the way to B. So that's how you handle just weird little breaks in functions and whatnot. Sometimes we actually even have to do this trick. I know this is a little extra here. We weren't planning on covering this in this video, but sometimes we can even do this when we have absolute value functions because they're not integrable. We don't know what the integral of the absolute value function is. So if you're integrating from one point to another, then one roundabout trick, I suppose, would be to integrate from A to the vertex, right? Because that's pretty straightforward. And then from the vertex on to the terminal point. And compute that definite integral there. So we use this idea of breaking integrals apart at difficult places, not just at jump discontinuities, but just really anytime we have trouble like that. So, anyways, hope that helps you understand definite integrals a little bit better, and hopefully you can use some shortcuts using these properties here to compute some of the definite integrals on your homework or your test or what have you.